And welcome back to AgriTalk as we wrap up our coverage of the 26th Annual International Fuel Ethanol Workshop and Expo. Our broadcast brought to you by Eisenman Clean Air and Energy Technology. Very happy to have with us Tom Bias, CEO of Growth Energy. Catching his breath here. Good to see you.
Great to see you, Mike. Great to be on the show.
How you been?
Great. Busy.
A lot happening, and we've been discussing on the program today a lot of the key issues. The E15 waiver, VTEC, these are all critical issues facing the ethanol industry. And really, when you look what's going to happen between now and the end of this year, it will greatly shape and determine the future direction of this industry.
Yes, it will, Mike. You mentioned a couple of big issues. Obviously, we're awaiting the phone call any day from EPA on the E15 waiver, which, as you know, we filed a year ago last March. We know there's ongoing tests going on at the Department of Energy, but, you know, I don't think there's ever been a waiver put to this kind of scrutiny before. We submitted all the data that is necessary in order to prove that going from E10 to E15 will not harm any auto engines, will not harm the emissions equipment. It's time to move forward. We know the benefits for America and national security, energy security, environmental improvements. I mean, if you look at current events, I don't know, we can wait. We could be waiting till the cows come home on testing if they just keep testing. Just make the decision and let's move forward. The second thing is the public policy arena, and you hinted at, and we're hopeful that the United States Senate is finally going to get around to doing energy legislation next month. There's a lot of things that have to be addressed, as we just talked at the in the forum here today. We still have this bizarre concept called indirect land use change penalty that's only being applied to biofuels. It's no other transportation fuel faces that kind of penalty. It's made up. It's not supported by facts. That was contained in the 2007 Act. It has to be removed, and that's going to be a high priority. The second one is there is a discrimination clause contained in the 07 Act, and that requires, that basically says corn starch-based ethanol cannot qualify as an advanced biofuel, even if it meets the 50% greenhouse gas emissions threshold. Someone in 07 knew what they were trying to do to try to put a dagger in the back of this industry. Those have to be removed. On the positive side, you know, ultimately to get around all of this complicated regulatory concept with RFS2, the low carbon fuel standard, E15, we need flex fuel vehicles and blender pumps in this country. And we need to accelerate the build out of that infrastructure. If you look at our nation's public policy since we've been formed, you know, the government has provided the infrastructure for roads, for highways, for rivers, for canals, for ports, for airports, you name it. They're even talking about doing infrastructure changes for natural gas fueled vehicles. We have to do it, and the best way is a flex fuel vehicle mandate and an incentive to put blender pumps not in 1,000, not in 5,000 stations, but 180,000 stations nationwide. That puts the power in the hands of the consumer. We don't have to worry about the blend wall. We can get to where we want to get to. And everyone says, well, Brazil did it. Why can't we? That's how they did it. They built out their infrastructure. We can, too.
Especially now, in light of what's happened in the Gulf, you would think it, we'd finally get to the point where those in positions of decision-making and power would say, let's get serious about this. Instead of just talking about it and in one hand saying, yeah, we support alternative energy, but then the actions don't seem to back it up all the time. It's time to get serious, as you say, and let's move this thing forward.
It is. Mike, as you know, this has been going on, this debate, for 40 years. The first OPEC embargo in 1973. We got to move forward, and we got to move forward now. And there's no better example than you look at the situation this nation is continuously in on our addiction to foreign oil. We can do it. It's great. It's America's fuel. It provides jobs here in America that can't be outsourced. It improves the environment. It stabilizes our energy security, and it helps our national security.
How is your campaign going to educate people about agriculture and about ethanol? You really stepped up and you made the financial commitment to help get that message out. How's it going?
I think it's going well. You know, a lot of people, and I have to give this word out there, or tell the people, our ads started before the oil spill. And I've been asked numerous times, well, can you guys see the future? Well, no, we can't see the future, but we certainly have learned from the past. And we know the downside to continued reliance on fossil fuel and foreign oil. And we got to move forward. We think it's the answer. We're an existing alternative today, not 30 years down the road, but today.
And finally, we've been talking about the whole VTEC situation. I mean, we can't let what's happened to biodiesel happen to the ethanol industry and let that expire at the end of the year.
Oh, well, the VTEC and the tariff are really critical. You know, we have a bunch of critics out there that are saying, oh, don't invest in biofuels, it's extensive. Look at what kind of tax subsidies and programs the oil industry received last year. A recent report a couple of weeks ago showed that they received $500 billion in tax subsidies. And you have environmental groups that, even in the midst of what's going on in the Gulf, that are out here saying, oh my gosh, don't spend $4.5 billion, $5 billion on building out the infrastructure of biofuels. They couldn't be more wrong.
Yeah, we just had a story a while ago, a Stanford University poll asking people what they did they support tax incentives and tax breaks, that kind of support for alternative energy. 84% said yes. I think the public is now ready for this.
Oh, they are ready, and they've been ready for a long time. I think you just you got a lot of vested interests that continue to fund studies and criticisms of biofuels because they don't want to see us succeed. We know we can, and we're going to.
Climate change legislation, what you see now, with whether it's Kerry Lieberman or whatever the bill may be, how do you see that impacting the ethanol industry?
Well, I don't think too many people in Washington would give much of a chance for climate legislation to be passed. I think ultimately what they'll do is some sort of energy package. Obviously, they're going to focus a lot of attention on the Gulf oil spill, and rightfully so. But we're hoping that they go far enough that they address a lot of these challenges that we just mentioned. Other items in there that I didn't mention was, it's like an ethanol pipeline. If you talk about lowering your carbon footprint, if you can ship ethanol with a pipeline across this country, you significantly lower the greenhouse gas emissions, you lower the cost to the consumer, it's more efficient. All those things need to be taken as a whole, and we can't get into this situation that it's one thing that we're after. It's a variety of things. How do we get to where we really benefit this nation? And I think we have to keep our eyes focused on that.
Critical time. Thanks, Tom. Good to see you.
Great. Thanks, Mike. Good to see you, buddy.
Tom Bias, he is the CEO of Growth Energy. With that, we'll wrap up our broadcast from the 26th Annual International Fuel and Ethanol Workshop here in downtown St. Louis. Our thanks to the folks at Eisenman Clean Air and Energy Technology for making our broadcast possible. Tomorrow, back in studio, we'll talk about crop insurance, the new proposals by USDA. We'll hear both from the Risk Management Agency and the crop insurers and get their thoughts and reaction to it as well, the crop insurance agents. So be sure to join us for that discussion tomorrow on AgriTalk.